Okay, so we finally made it to the end. This is the conclusion video for the conclusion paragraph and the conclusion of this series of videos on basics of college level paper writing. So for the conclusion, I first want to cover what you should not do in a conclusion paragraph. Do not simply repeat what you've already said in the introductory paragraph and throughout the body paragraphs. I know there are a lot of composition books who teach this or that teach this technique. I have absolutely no idea why. It makes no sense at all. As you have already explained to your reader your thesis statement and all of your reasons and the points that back up those reasons throughout the entire paper. And then for some reason, at the very end, you're going to tell them which you've already told them numerous times throughout the paper. It doesn't make any sense. And I would challenge anybody to go find an essay written by a professional writer in a newspaper, in a magazine. Go looking and find anyone that does this. It doesn't exist because it doesn't make any sense. So instead of doing that, there's got to be a better way, and that's what I'm hopefully going to show you right now. Don't simply repeat what you've already said throughout your paper. I would recommend, and this is not a hard, fast rule, but I would recommend not using the words "in conclusion." Because if you're honest with yourself, as a reader, when you read the words "in conclusion," you probably assume, as soon as you read those words, that you are gonna simply hear a repetition of what has already been said. We are conditioned to believe that those two words, "in conclusion," are automatically gonna lead to nothing but nothing, essentially. So by avoiding those words in your conclusion, you are inviting your reader to read your conclusion paragraph instead of basically saying, you can stop right here because there's not gonna be anything of any use or any value to you past this point. So I would recommend skipping those words. Do not contain additional support for your thesis. If you have another reason that you go, ooh, I'd like to just plug this in at the end, that is not your conclusion paragraph. You have started another body paragraph. So you better start with a topic sentence and come up with some points to back that up, because you're not done writing yet, not done making your argument yet, and you will not have a 5-paragraph, you will have a 6-paragraph essay. If that's the case. Do not expect readers to come to their own conclusions about your paper. Hopefully this paper has shown you that eating rat poison is bad. I mean, I hope it has, because I'm not a very smart person and I just don't, oh, I stink. Don't apologize in your writing. Make sure that your reader, you've done it. You've explained throughout the entire paper exactly what it is that you want your reader to know and what you want your reader to maybe even do. So feel confident in that fact. And when you conclude your paper, feel confident in the fact that you've done what it is that you've promised them that you're going to do throughout the paper. So instead, here's what you ought to do. When your reader gets down to the end of the last body paragraph, and they're about to start your conclusion, I think it's a perfectly fair question for every reader to ask, so what? Like, so what does this have to do with me? We're selfish people. We want to see what in the world all of this has to do with me and my life. So help them to understand. Let them see. Let me explain to you why this is important. Let me explain to you why this is maybe helpful to you in some way. But at the very least, give them something to think about. Leave them thinking. Leave them like you leave a movie sometimes going, oh man, I never really thought about it from that perspective before. Give them something to ponder after they've finished reading your paper. And what a lot of composition books will also tell you to do is go broad again. A lot of composition books will point out that well-written essays look like hourglasses in their shape. So you will start, as we learned with the introductory techniques videos ago, with something that is broad. So even though we learn broad to narrow is one of the techniques, really, they all start broad. They start with a story, and they work their way down to what it is that you have come to conclude about your life or about a certain situation because of that story or experience, you're starting with a broad topic and narrowing it down to what it is you have to say about the topic. So you're focusing the paper on something very narrow. At the end, bring it back out broad again. Bring it out to the real world. Make it applicable to your readers' lives. It's going to, instead of making the conclusion paragraph just a perfunctory paragraph that doesn't really have any purpose in the paper, other than, that's all, folks, that it actually turns it into something that is going to help your readers see why it's important to them. All right, so let me give you an example here. Here is a thesis statement from an intro paragraph that was written from one of my students. And they were analyzing a Got Milk ad campaign. So they're looking at an advertisement and they're explaining how this advertisement is actually influencing in us. So the entire paper is dealing with how the Got Milk ad campaign plays on our emotions, our values, and our desires to see famous people. So each body paragraph was going to be addressing each of these. One paragraph on emotions, one on how it's affecting our values, and one how it's affecting our desires to see famous people. In each of those paragraphs, there were multiple points that were backing up and helping to explain how the Got Milk ad is doing this. So it doesn't do any good at the end to then repeat everything that I've already told them. So listen to the difference in this conclusion right here. The Got Milk ads are certainly not the only places where these tactics are used. In fact, all advertising uses them. These tactics, however, lose their effectiveness once we understand that we're being manipulated and how we're being manipulated. In turn, all advertising becomes as easy to interpret and dismiss as these Got Milk ads are. So what makes this really interesting is what this person is doing is instead of just repeating everything they've said, look, I've just got finished telling you about a Got Milk advertisement. And the reader more than likely is going to end the paper going, so what? Who cares? It's a Got Milk ad. This person says, let me tell you why it's important. Because it's not just this ad doing it. It's all advertisement doing it. And now that you've understood this one Got Milk advertisement, you can understand all these other ads. And you can see not only that you're being manipulated, but you can see exactly how those ads are potentially manipulating you. So it's pretty clever. Look at a play on this that this student was practicing different techniques or trying out different techniques to see which one of these would work better. And you can see she was using the same type of technique here, but expanded it a little bit. She says, if the Got Milk ads attempts to influence us or helping the sales of milk and milk products, which they must be because of the prominence of these ads in magazines and on billboards, then it should make us wonder how many other advertisers are using similar tactics. After all, it's probable that politicians, news pundits, and religious leaders are also using similar strategies to convince or deceive us. However, by recognizing these tactics in the Got Milk ads, we now have valuable armor that we can use to protect ourselves from all these influences, no matter where we see or hear them. So this is pretty clever right here, because what it does is it actually shows not only do you understand advertising better, but you also now, when you listen to somebody who is trying to convince you of something, whether it be a politician, a news pundit, a religious leader, you say, I know what you're doing. This is the same thing that I read in that paper about the Got Milk advertisement. And you're trying to get to me and it's not going to work because I'm an educated person now. So do you see how this makes it a much more interesting paragraph than just simply repeating everything that has been said? Let me show you an example that has been online for a while, showing people how to write a 5-paragraph essay. And it has a lot of positives in this particular essay, but I would say one of the negatives to this essay is the conclusion. And so notice that, and this is a strong introduction. When many people hear the word Africa, they picture steaming jungles and gorillas. Hollywood films have shrunk the public image of this immense varied continent into a small segment of its actual diversity. To have a more accurate picture of the whole continent, however, one should remember that there are roughly 3 Africas, each with its distinct climate and terrain and with a style of life suited to the environment. The continent can be divided into the northern desert areas, the southeastern grasslands, and the tropical jungles. That's a really solid intro, because what it does is it helps me to understand, why are you even talking about the three different regions of Africa? Well, I'm talking about it because look what Hollywood has done. They've made us think that the entire continent is just steaming jungles and gorillas. And so the entire paragraph, or the entire body of this paper, is dedicated to these three different regions of Africa to help us to better understand it. But listen to the way this paper concludes, and it's just more obvious, since we're not reading the body, what they're doing here. Even a superficial look at the major regions of Africa shows that it's a varied continent with several environments. Although most of the continent is tropical in its range of temperature, the climate ranges from deserts to rainforest. Basically, we are just getting a rewording of everything that has already been said in this paper. And so there's really no reason to do that, because it's already been stated. We've already read that before. I would say this is a weak conclusion. So if I were grading this paper, I'd say that's not so swift. All you're doing is just rewording what you've already said before. So let me show you maybe a way that we could fix this paragraph, or make it better. Understanding that Africa has many different types of people and landscapes makes it impossible to revert back to the stereotypes presented in the movies. In fact, this new understanding should make us leery of many of these stereotypes that we too often embrace without questioning. After all, as James Jones once said, people can only be understood when stereotypes are pushed aside. So what you've done then, when you conclude the paper this way, is you've shown people, hey, look, this is important that Africa has three different regions, if for no other reason than to point out we're doing nothing but stereotyping. And where else are you maybe doing this in your life? That if you look at yourself honestly and look at the way you're looking at the world, are you really giving a fair look and a fair representation of those people or those places that we come into contact with? So hopefully that gives you a way to think about concluding your paragraphs. Now, I'm going to end this entire series with just a few things and stuff that you need to know that hopefully are going to even make your paper even better. And one of the first things I want to point out is things and stuff. Don't use those in your paper. Those are meaningless words. Some people, when they first start learning to write, will thing and stuff me to death. There are things throughout papers. I always tell my students, I said, if you can tell me what a thing is, I will let you use it in your paper. And, you know, of course, then people say, well, things are anything and everything and nothing. All of those words are completely and utterly bland and worthless and don't do much to help me to understand what it is that you are trying to say. So if you say that there are things in this world that upset you, I know you're ticked off about something, but I have no idea what it is. Whereas if you say war, famine, and stupid people upset me, now I understand exactly what it is that you're having to say. So this also applies, like I said, to words like everything. Everything changed the day that I met my girlfriend. Really? Everything changed? So cats started barking, we started breathing grape jelly instead of oxygen, the earth stopped revolving around the sun. I doubt it was everything that changed. So be more specific about what it is you have to say. My ideas of relationships changed the day that I met my girlfriend. That completely and utterly changes and makes it clear what it is that you're trying to say. And if somebody says, don't put things in your paper, and you say, okay, I'm going to change things and put items in there, that doesn't do any good. There are items in this world that upset me. You have not clarified anything. You have just replaced one empty word with another empty word. The other things that I want to point out are titles. You need them. Try to make them clever. Nobody has ever read the title of a paper, Paper One, and go, man, this is going to be good right here. I'm going to love this. Try to make it at least clever. Try to make it interesting. Hokey is always better than boring. So if it's hokey, you might get a snide comment from your professor, but they're probably not going to, you know, be completely bored out of their gourd or not even want to read your paper. The word or the abbreviation, etc., don't use that in your paper, because if you're honest with yourself, there are only two reasons that you really use etc. One of them is, as my students will say, because you're lazy and you don't want to list all the items. Not a good way to probably get an argument across to somebody, hey, I'm too lazy to write all this stuff down. Why would you listen to a lazy person? But if you're really honest, that's not really the reason you use etc. more than likely. Probably you use etc. because you can't think of anything else and you're trying to make it way bigger than what it really is. There are a lot of things in this world that are messed up, like war and famine, etc. Don't make it bigger than what it is. Say what you've got to say, and that will be enough. And then finally, never ever, and this should make complete sense after watching the body paragraph videos that I did, don't start with quotes at the beginning of a body paragraph. That is where topic sentences go. Quotes can support topic sentences, but quotes cannot be topic sentences. So if you start with a quote, there's problems with that, and I will probably be doing a video sometime in the near future that is going to explain how to actually integrate quotes into your arguments as well. Hopefully this is useful, and good luck completing your paper, and I look forward to creating some other videos in the future.